falling in love with you.
You deserve it all, Jesus. can certainly feel His presence here. I think you're going to sense a greater presence of God here in just a moment. Gilda, please, could you come up with baby? And talk about God deserving the highest praise. Take a look at this little guy. Pretty awesome, right? Come over here, Jessica. Come over here, Tim. This is Gilda. You gotta say hello to Gilda. Many of you know Gilda very, very well, even if you've never seen her. I feel like I'm way too tall there. So Gilda is Jessica's bestie, and they've been besties since they were about his size. Since they were four, yeah. So they're really sisters, if you think about it. They're real sisters. Look at that smile, man. Is that totally cool? Like, he's got happy figured out right there, that guy. So I'll let you in a little secret that I found out today. She was, I guess you were sleeping, and she felt like this voice. She heard this voice tell her, Caleb. That's what you're to name your child. Caleb. So that's Caleb. I'm going to say a few things so that Jessica can get her crying out of the way before we move on. Yeah. So Jessica's been praying that Jesus would invade Gilda's heart. It's got me too. For a long time. Oh, man. Jesus is good. So she's been praying that Jesus would invade Gilda's heart and she would be a member of God's family. And today in that room right there, she said yes. So in just a moment, the best thing that could ever happen is that Jessica is going to baptize Gilda right there in just a minute. But before we give Gilda the spotlight here, we're going to give spotlight on that little dude right there, because he's adorable. And so what Gilda's decided is that she would like to, commit to the Lord and to you, her extended church family, even though she doesn't live here yet, that she wants to just let you know, and she wants the Lord to know that she's going to, by God's grace, her greatest ability, she is going to raise that little boy, Caleb, to know Jesus. And she has committed to not only teach this little guy, but also to model Christ-like character before him, so that he would be led towards the Savior, not away, right? That was her commitment to us earlier. We talked about it earlier. But now I got a question for you guys. And I know that she doesn't live here, but a lot of you know her, and you can be very, very close to her, even though she's not close to you physically. You can pray for her, right? You can pray for the baby. And so what I just want to ask you, Revolution family, is would you, it's kind of like a wedding right here, would you make that commitment right now? And we're going to fail, I get it, but would you make that commitment right now? And by God's grace, you would, every time that he pops into your mind or she pops into your mind, that you would pray on behalf of this little boy, that God would bless his life. Would you do that? And would you, when they come and visit, would you commit now to live a life of Christ-like character before his eyes, so that, especially you guys, so that he would see what it looks like to be a godly man? Would you all do that? You do that? Okay. So let's just start that process right now. Why don't we just bow our heads? Well, you know what you could do? You can just put your hand, like, I don't know if there's any meaning to it really, but I think it's a good thing to do. We could just point our hands towards little Caleb, and we could point our hands towards Gilda, and we could pray for them right now. All your thoughts are on her and him right now. Lord, we want to thank you and acknowledge you for Caleb. It is obvious that your hand is on him. You named him. I thank you for her obedience to hear your voice and respond. That obedience was evident even greater today as she heard your voice calling her home and she responded by saying yes. Lord, I pray for this little baby boy. I pray, Lord, that you would use him in a mighty way. Lord, I pray against anything that the evil one would ever want for his life. Lord, that God, you would protect him and that only what you want for him would enter into his life. Lord, I pray that you would guide him down a path that leads him to his greatest potential. Lord, I pray that you would use him in a mighty way for your kingdom. And Lord, I ask that you would bless his mommy. I pray that you would bless Jilda, Lord, to give her the strength and the courage and the boldness to lead him and lead him well. Lord, I pray that on days when she feels weak, that she would sense your strength bubbling up inside of her to persevere on. And Lord, I pray that you would just help her and strengthen her and give her the wisdom she needs to lead this child into your loving arms. Lord, I pray that you would protect her, that you would love on her. And that you would love on him. Lord, I pray right now in the name of Jesus that this young man would come to know you personally as Lord and Savior and know you soon, Lord. I can't wait, Lord. And we praying right now in expectation that someday soon he will come back here and we will see him in that tank. Lord, I thank you for that. I just ask your blessing upon our commitments today as a church family, that you would help us to keep our commitments, Lord. We're so easily distracted, Lord, but it is in our heart right now to bless this family, to love on them with an unconditional love, to always be thinking about them, to always be lifting them up in prayer, and to help where we can. We ask for your blessing on this little baby boy. Let him grow up to be a mighty hero of God. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Awesome. Revolution. That is the question that we are endeavoring to answer for ourselves, right? That's the most important question any man or woman really could answer. And I'm quite sure that 100, 200, 300, 3,000 years from now, all the other questions will probably fade away. But that question is the most important. It's the only one that's going to really matter. And so we started a message series, about 2 months ago, preaching through the Gospel of Luke so we could find out who this Jesus Christ is. And so this week we'll be in Luke chapter 6, and I would welcome you to grab a copy of God's Word. This is a Bible church, and so that's what we do. We read the Bible, we study God's Word, we apply it to our lives. Anyone need a Bible? Anyone? Raise your hand. Don't be ashamed. There's plenty of them everywhere. Don't short yourself. Make sure you get a copy of it in front of you. If you have a device, you can go ahead and use one of those as well. But we're going to be in the second half of Luke chapter 6 this week, and we're going to be pursuing truth about who Jesus is, what he did, what he does, and what he will do, and the truth of what he taught. And so that's what we're going to be doing here tonight. And really, what's the reason why we're doing that? The reason why we're doing that is to fan the flames of Spirit-filled worship, right? So in order for that Spirit to come kind of flooding out of you, right, you got to get some truth in you so you can get the Spirit out of you, right? So that's what we're doing. We're pursuing the truth, because when the truth of who Jesus Christ really is, when your mind finally wraps itself around the truth of who Jesus Christ is, there's no other response other than worship, right? You can't do anything but, right? And so when we worship Jesus, and especially collectively when we worship Jesus, Jesus is present here in a mighty way. When the scriptures will tell us that when people walk into your gatherings, here's a gathering, they walk in and they see us speaking his words and prophesying and singing his words, right? And when there's that connection, it says that they'll notice that God is there with them. Right, and that's what we're looking for when we gather. Look, I don't want to come in here just to sing a few songs and go home. Right, I want to experience the living God. I want to. Did you know that he's here right now? Yeah. Yeah, you know that, right? Do you know that he's in your car when you're driving home from work? Do you know that he's in the kitchen when you're doing dishes? Yeah, but we don't always sense him there, do we? As a matter of fact, when we're doing dishes, we probably sense something else. Or someone else, right? But he's there. And a lot of places that you go and spend your time in, you don't sense Jesus Christ there. He's there, but you don't sense that he's there. And the church gathering is a place where you could come in and you should be able to sense the presence of the Almighty. That's what we do when we gather. So you want to know who this Jesus is, right? And what's this Christianity all about? A lot of people are wondering, right? You might be here tonight. You might not be a Christian. I don't know. Maybe you're just investigating. That's a good place to be. You're investigating about this Christianity. You've heard lots of things. You've listened to a lot of people tell you who Jesus is and what the Bible is and what church is supposed to be about. And honestly, most of it kind of stinks. Most of it is kind of stinky. You've heard out of Christians' mouths some really vile things, right? You've gone to some churches, you've seen some crazy things. And so what we want to do is we want to just discard all that peripheral stuff. We want to focus our eyes on the Word of God so we can know who Jesus Christ really is, what this Christianity is all about. So this section that we're going to study, that we've been studying the last couple weeks, and we'll continue to this week in Luke 6, this is what people, not God's Word, but God's people call this the Sermon on the Mount. And it looks like a good place to get some information about Jesus Christ. It's all in red. It's in quotes, right? So this is Jesus Christ talking. The second person of the Trinity is now speaking to you. And so I think that's an awesome place to be, don't you? And so what I want to do right now is I want to take a few moments and I want to pray with you, because I think that God, he deserves your full attention. He deserves you to be off your cell phone. He deserves for you to be focused on him, not be thinking about anything else, but be focusing on Jesus so Jesus can speak to you. So let's take a moment and let's pray and ask God to help us with that, because who in here honestly can tell me, just tell me, that you're easily distracted? Raise your hand. So you need help, right? You all need help, right? Look at your neighbor and say, you need help. Right? So let's ask the one who can help us, right? Let's do this. Let's close our eyes for just a second. Let's focus. Let's focus, all right? Father, your word tells us that it is you, not anyone else, not anything else, that gives us the will and the desire to do what pleases you. And so, Lord, we need your help. We just admitted our weakness and our failure. So we need your help to, we need you to help us focus on what you're trying to tell us here tonight. You know, we need ears to hear. We need eyes to see. So Lord, we right now, we just, the best that we can, we just come before you admitting our frailty, and we're asking you to give us a heart to receive, to give us a mind that is open to your word, to give us ears to hear what you're really trying to tell us individually and then collectively as a church. We need your help with that. So I'm just asking you, Father, on behalf of all of us here, Lord, just give us a heart to hear you. We want to submit ourselves right now to the authority of God's word. But Lord, that is difficult as well. We don't like to be told what to do. Neither does the man speaking. But I'm asking you, Father, to soften my heart, break down whatever wall would get in the way of your word. Your word is life, and I need it. We all do. So we're asking for your help. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, so let me ask you guys this. How many people had a chore list when they were a kid? That's it? About half of you? A chore list. Chore. Anyone have any chores? Lots of chores? Were they wicked awesome? Okay, so you had chore lists, right? So there it is. They weren't awesome, were they? Nobody likes a chore list. Nobody likes their parents telling them what to do, right? It's not fun. But what's the reason, now that you're a little bit older, right? You can look at it with hindsight. What's the reason, now that most of us are parents, what's the reason we give our kids a chore list? Is it because you're an awful parent and you're wicked? It's the only thing that's funny if you know those parents are sitting right there. Okay, so are your parents wicked and evil because mom doesn't want to do dishes? Is she wicked and evil because she doesn't want to cook, so it's good if you just cook for her? Is that really? I mean, does anyone, now that you're an adult, do you think that that's the case? No, there's actually a higher thing there, right? They're trying to teach you with these actions. They're trying to teach you and conform you into an image that will be very productive later on in life, right? So the chore list, although is awful and we hate it at the time, it's for a greater purpose, right? And so I say that because this section of Scripture, if you open up this Sermon on the Mount and you start reading it, and in Luke, it's chapter 6, verse 20 through 42, so it's 22 verses of someone telling you, don't do this and do that. Like, that's lame. I don't like to be told what to do. Nobody likes to be told what to do. And so here's Jesus, right from his mouth, telling you, do this and don't do that. Totally lame. And you're reading this and you're like, what? What's the point in all of this? Because to me, I'm reading this, it's just like, this is what everyone hates about Christianity. Like, it's a bunch of rules that tell you have to do this and you have to do that, or you can't do this. Jesus is the cosmic fun sucker in the sky trying to ruin your life, right? Now, this whole thing about these orders and this nonstop 22 verses of telling us something that seem to have no, to me, redemptive value, and you'll see that there is as we read on. But it's like, do this and do, so. Okay, so I have a daughter. I have a lot of kids, but Adriana is a lot of you, all of you know Adriana. She's 12 years old, and She goes to Hampton DuBose Academy, which is almost Zellwood. Okay, so I live in Tavares, so it takes about 20 minutes to get there. Well, my little girl is she has some vivid dreams. I don't have the vivid dreams. If I do, I don't remember them. But she has vivid dreams, and she's when she gets in the car, it's like I'd say probably 75% of the time she's like, "Hey, Daddy, I had a dream. Can I tell you?" And I'm like, oh. The reason why I'm like that is because I'm wicked and evil. I don't want to hear it. The reason why I don't want to hear it is because my little girl has this tendency of, and I don't know if you guys have little girls, but everything is, and then I like, and then she did like, and then like, and 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 like. Does anyone know what I'm talking about, like? Right? So like this, and then she tells the story, and she includes every single, to me, insignificant little point to this dream. And it's usually like, I just did it. It's usually about 30 seconds before we pull into the driveway at the school that she gets to the stinking point. And the whole ride, she's been telling me all this. And then finally, we got somewhere, and I'm like, oh, okay, yeah. And she's like, isn't that funny? Yeah, that's awesome. That's so funny. So the reason why I'm telling you this in tonight's message is this. I've been stressing, we're a Bible church. We read the Bible. We study the Bible. Okay, that's what we do. But as of late, I've really been kind of hammering home this need to study God's Word. Like, I'm not talking about just reading it once in a while, write a little daily Bible verse that comes on the phone. That's all a great place to start. If that's all you do, I love you, and it's a good start. But I'm talking about, like, studying the Bible from Genesis to Revelation. Like tearing into it, reading it, right? Studying what it means, getting it, right? Then meditating on its meaning for you personally, like understanding the whole of Scripture. Like, we have to do this, because if you don't, and you just kind of rip open the Bible whenever you want, and you just go, all right, Lord, I'm having a bad day. What do I need to hear? Boom. Like, I understand that God is sovereign and all that stuff, and He'll lead you to the right place, and maybe He'll do that for you. But if you open up a section of Scripture and you start reading it, like this section, the Sermon on the Mount, when you read it, it's just Jesus barking out a bunch of orders telling you what you shouldn't do. And so if you read this and you're kind of investigating this Jesus in Christianity, you might think to yourself, well, this section right here, this just says that the pinnacle, the apex of Christian success is some type of behavior modification, that if you just do this and don't do that, that somehow if you keep all these rules, that you'll make God happy. That's not the case. See, that's man-made religion. Men take the perfect word of God and they change it into that. Do all this and God will be happy with you. But that's not what God does. God uses that same word, but He has a higher goal in mind. Just like your chore list when you were little. You thought, man, this is just telling me what I can and cannot do. And all the while, your parents are like, no, I'm trying to train you for something. Something higher, something better. And that's what God is doing here in this section of Scripture. There's a higher goal. So you're going to see that, and I don't want to read the whole thing because we've been through this for weeks now and it would take too long to read the whole section, but here He is talking about, you know, loving your enemies, bless those that curse you. If someone slaps you, give them the other cheek, give them your shirt. Love your enemies. Do all this stuff. Lend to them when they have no money. You can give them money. Be generous. I mean, that's crazy stuff. Don't judge people. Don't condemn them. Make sure you forgive everybody. Give like crazy. Don't expect anything back. Do this, do that, right? But the goal in all this is found in verse 43 through 45. It's the follow-up to this whole list of stuff to do. I would welcome you to read it. I'm going to read it with you right now. You ready? You there? Okay. A good tree can't produce bad fruit, and a bad tree can't produce good fruit. A tree is identified by its fruits. Fruit, pardon me. Figs are never gathered from thorn bushes, and grapes are not picked from bramble bushes. A good person produces good things from the treasury of a good heart, And an evil person produces evil things from the treasury of an evil heart. What you say flows from what is in your heart. Now, I would never dare to add to God's word, but would you agree with me, and you can disagree with you want, when it says that what you say flows from what's in your heart, would you agree that what you do also would do the same thing? Where's that coming from, right? Okay. So the goal, the higher goal that's mentioned here is the inward transformation of the reader from a reciprocator, right? Generally, people reciprocate. That's the relationship. They reciprocate. You do this to me, I do it back to you. Wouldn't you agree? That's just the way people generally are. And so the goal here is a transformed heart, to change the reader from a reciprocator to an initiator, right? That's what he's trying to do. A changed heart is the goal. See, if Jesus gets your heart, then you and everything around you is changed. And that's a win. That's a big win. See, if you just change the outer, that doesn't necessarily get you to the inner. But if you change the inner, then it gets to the outer, right? Everything comes, as you read in God's word. Everything that you say, everything that you do, it all comes from what's inside here. So the goal is transformation of the heart, not just your actions. You get me? So it's a heart attack from God. This is Jesus Christ building his church by tenaciously pursuing your heart and mine. That's what he does. Okay? A changed heart is good. And that's the goal. Every time you come here, every time you open God's word, every time you're on your knees, every time you sing his praises, every time you behold his glory, he is trying to do what? Change your heart. Because it's good for you. It's good for you. Okay? It's good for you. Let me share with what I'm talking about. Where do I get this idea that it's good for me? Well, Jesus goes on. In verse 46, he explains further. He's talking about the changed heart. Everything flows on the outside from what's on the inside. And he continues in the very next verse. He says, so why do you keep calling me Lord, Lord, when you don't do what I say? And I'll show you what it's like when someone comes to me, listens to my teaching, and then follows it. So he's gonna teach you right now what it's like when someone's heart is changed and they become obedient to the Lord, they accept the Lordship of Jesus Christ in their life. He's going to show you what it means, what's going to happen, what it should look like. It's like a person building a house who digs deep and lays the foundation on solid rock. When the floodwaters rise and break against that house, anyone ever have any of those? Anyone have any waters banging up against the walls of your house? Like, not literally, I'm talking about your life, right? Where it gets rough. When the seas are rough and the night is dark and things are coming at you like crazy and you feel like you're about to sink. Anyone ever feel that way? Because if you do, this is for you. See, that house, if you build it on the rock, it stands firm because it is built well. But anyone who hears and doesn't obey is like a person who builds a house without a foundation. When the floodwaters sweep down against the house, it will collapse into a heap of ruins. How often have I sat at home at night with my wife, and we have our issues too, where none of us are perfect, I get it, but how often have we sat at home and grieved over people in our church that we love that will do exactly this? They will sit here and they will hear it, but they will not do it. And they crash. And before you know it, they're over in the ditch somewhere. Their marriage is falling apart. They're in jail. They're drinking again. Just disaster. And it breaks my heart. And I can't even imagine how Jesus feels about it. When all the while, everything that we need for life, to be set free, to live abundantly, it's right here. And it breaks my heart to see when people will listen and not do what it says. And so you see this big long list of stuff that you're supposed to do, and all the while, Jesus is like, man, I'm just going for your heart. Yes. Do you think I give a rip if you tithe? Right? God doesn't have a bank account. Wells Fargo didn't affect him. Do you know what I'm saying? Like, he don't care about that. What he's trying to do is to set you free. Right? He's there. He's telling you these things because it's good for you. Right? It's good for you. When you forgive someone who wronged you, what if they don't even care? But aren't you feeling better? Like, he's trying to give you a gift. Yes. Just be obedient to what he says, and it's helpful for you. Give in to the lordship of Jesus Christ. I recently went with my wife and some of the others here at the church. We went up to Chicago, and we went and saw, we went to Harvest University, this church planting conference. It was just an amazing experience. I know I've shared it with a lot of you, and it was an incredible, incredible time of worship, and they were equipping us for the work of the ministry. It was just an amazing time of growth for all of us that went. 3,000 people gathered in a room, incredible worship time, incredible learning. It was amazing. One of the people that I didn't get to meet him, but he spoke, and this guy's name is John Kelly. And John Kelly got on the stage with two other men and a moderator, and they spoke about the ethnic tension in our country and the Black Lives Matter thing and the violence between certain ethnicities and the police. And how does the church deal with all that? How are we supposed to be the ones to lead the way in seeing that gets better in our country? And just side note, it is our responsibility. I just want to let you know, in case you're wondering, we are the ones who should speak out about it. We are the ones who should embrace people of different ethnic backgrounds so that the world can see, hey, he gets along with this black guy. That's pretty cool. I guess they don't hate each other. I guess they're both people. That would be kind of nice. Like, we can embrace in Walmart and people go, oh, I guess they're not crazy. I mean, they're just normal people. Like, right? We could love each other and maybe the world would see something different. Okay, so I'll get up my soapbox. But this guy got up there and he shared some amazing testimony and he taught. But I didn't know anything about this guy. I just know now he's a pastor at one of these Harvest Bible chapels in Chicago. But there's just a little video I just want you to see about this guy. So just give him a few moments of your attention. Talking about a transformed life.
Majority of my life growing up is my mother, my little sister and I. Just as a single parent, you can imagine my mother wasn't around a lot. She worked like 2-3 jobs, went to school. She tried her best to like give my sister and I an opportunity. I was always in the streets. By the time I turned 12 years old, I was selling crack in crack houses, really getting into a lot of trouble. I went to 3 different high schools in my freshman year. I got kicked out of the first high school I went to for selling drugs, and they sent me to a disciplinary school. And it got to the point where the guys around, we started robbing drug dealers. One night that situation turned fatal when I was with a group of friends. We robbed the home of a drug dealer in a neighborhood in which one of my friends shot and killed him. And we all ended up getting arrested. And so I was 19 years old, headed to prison. It was a Christian guard who worked the block. And I asked him for something to read. And looking back, I don't know what he was doing, but he said, well, I don't have anything to read. I don't have anything that you can read. Only thing we have is Bibles, and I can give you a Bible. He came back like an hour later. He knocked on my door, opened the slot, and he gave me this little blue Bible. I remember looking at it, and I was like, all right, I'm just going to sit down and read this Bible. And I sat on the bed, and I read from Matthew chapter 1, and I read all the way through to Hebrews for like hours. I just read straight, slowly. I meditated on what I was reading, reflecting on it, because I had so much time. And by the time I got to Hebrews, I was so broken. It was just like my eyes was open. I don't know how to describe it. And I just saw all the sins and the wickedness of it, and I really saw how disgusting I was. I just started praying. I was like, you know, Jesus, like, if you're real, like, you, I got into a lot of trouble in my life, and you delivered me from it, and you don't have to deliver me from this one. I just want to ask you just to forgive me of all this mess that I got myself into and all these sins. I thought about everything I did and how he protected me. I just wanted him to just be there for me because I had no one. I must have prayed what they call a sinner's prayer like a million times for like the next 2 months because I had no one. I didn't have anyone preach to me. It wasn't like someone came and preached a sermon, or it was me and the living God one-on-one. All I had was my Bible, and I must have read it like 80 times during a year and a half. Never saw a TV, never saw anything outside of that block in that cell for about 18 months. And then I finally got sentenced, and I went in front of the judge, and I went in front of the victim's family, and I just turned to them and I said, I know it sounds, you know, you hear it all the time, but I follow Christ now, and if I could switch places with your son, I so would. And in a split second, I would, and I'm really grieved for everything, and whatever you want to do to me, you can do to me, and I accept it. It was there in that church that I met my wife, the woman who would be my wife. We both were serving in the youth ministry as youth workers. I actually ended up sharing my story with her because she asked me. It's like, man, she's really going to just shut down on me now. Nobody's going to want to, you know, take a chance with a guy that just came out of prison like a year ago for what I was in there for. But no condemnation, and just a ton of encouragement and love. And by God's grace, he gave me a sweet woman. And also, I had a little swag too. I had a little bit of swagger, so that probably got her too. We arrived in Chicago a year and a half ago with no jobs and about like $700 in the bank. And I was just like, Lord, I trust you. You want me to be here. You got to take care of it. I'm just going to speak and do whatever you want me to do and serve and whatever. And God worked it all out. So now I work part-time at Moody Bible Institute in the facilities department. And then I also work part-time on staff at the cathedral downtown with campus pastor Brian Beeman, which has been like a real blessing for me to just, you know, I never thought in my years I'd be on staff here. And then sometimes I sit here and I'm in worship on Sunday and I'm just like in awe of like, how did I get here? You know, you just look around and it's just like, wow. I think the big thing that I want people to see in my story is the greatness of God. I think it's so easy to look on the news or look at people and not have any mercy and to see no hope. And to see that God is still, he doesn't work like that. Like, he is different. He is totally set apart. He's holy. He has his children all over, and he goes after them. He pursues them. And so my hopes and prayer here would be that people will see that from my story and have hope, can look to Christ and say, you know what, if he can save John, he can do that in anyone's life. He can do that for my cousin. He can do that for my uncle. He can do that for anyone. And as we look around the city of Chicago, and look in some hopeless situations, some hopeless neighborhoods, we can have hope and say, you know what? Maybe there are some Sauls out there. Maybe there are some Pauls out there. Maybe there are some Johns out there that God wants to reach.
Awesome. Man, he gives us so much to talk about there in his message. So many things we could discuss. Just so amazing. You know, it's incredible. When I sat in my seat and I watched this man speak, I mean, you could never tell he's been in prison for 6 years for murder. I mean, and it was incredible. And then I'm listening. I didn't even pick up on it before, but how about the church giving him an opportunity? How about a guy comes out of prison for murder and he goes and applies for a job at a secular job? That's not really good for him, right? That's usually not going to be a hiring opportunity, is it? But he walked into a church and they let him serve in the children's ministry. I mean, in youth ministry, that's amazing. Just giving, so living up to the whole idea of giving people another chance because they've actually died and rose again, right? A new life. And so evidence of God at work, for sure, you know, a changed heart. And you could see what happened. He's in the cell block for 18 months, and he read his Bible 80 times. And you can see evidence of what has happened to this man through the Spirit of God and the power of the Word of God in his life. And it's amazing. And I love what he said that in Chicago, and I'm gonna say that here in Leesburg and Mount Dora and Eustace and Tavares, there are places where there seems to be no hope as well, right? But there's hope. God can shine light into those dark areas at any time. And so we need to be praying for people that God would do the same thing. So you see here in this section of Scripture, here in the Sermon on the Mount, there's this kind of a short list of you know, don't judge, don't condemn, make sure you forgive and give generously. This is kind of like this short list. This short list compared to all of this. Like, this whole thing is a big list of things that we're to do and not to do. Joshua 1:8 sums it up perfectly for us, and don't feel the pressure of this, but hear the truth of God's Word. It says, to do all the Word commands, and you will prosper and succeed in all that you do. So a transformed heart, a changed heart, is actually very good for you, okay? So not only is the changed heart good for you, as you can see evidenced in this guy, John's life, and you can see evidenced in my life, and you can see evidenced in your own life. I'm sure you can look back on your own life and see, okay, this is where I was, and then Jesus invaded my life, and now look at where I am now. So I'm not all I could be, but I'm a lot better than I was. So a lot of us can see evidence to this truth that's found in God's Word. But it's not just good for you personally. The changed heart of the Christian is also good for those that are around you, okay? Now, if you look at the text here, this Sermon on the Mount, it tells us that we should be loving people and praying for them and blessing them and giving to them and forgive them and be compassionate to them, right? This is what God's Word is telling us to do. Well, you got to know something, and you probably already do, but all those things that we are called to do, they all have a recipient, don't they? Every one of those things that you as the Christ follower are to do has a recipient, and this recipient has wronged you. That's the context here. Pray for those who curse you. Bless those, right? Love your enemy. If they slap you, right? This is people who have wronged you. Not just in general, just specifically do this stuff to people who have wronged you. You have to get this detail. It's very, very important. And Jesus calls you to not reciprocate, but to initiate. Why? Why is he calling you to initiate? Because the process of the transformed heart in that person starts with you. It's critical. You got to get this. You have to get this. And if you think about it, isn't that Jesus' fingerprint? Isn't that exactly how Jesus pursued you? Paul would put it this way in Colossians 1:21. He said, you were God's enemy, separated from him by your evil thoughts and actions. So what that means is that you and I have wronged God. Every single one of us has wronged God, right? Do you admit this? You have to admit this. You need to know that you're a sinner. Every one of us has sinned and fallen short of God's perfect standard. All of us. We have wronged him. The verse goes on, though. It says, yet, like, even so, I know you did this, he's saying. Yet now, he, not you, not anyone else, not your mama, he has reconciled you to himself through the death of Christ. See, you have wronged God, yet he kind of just says, well, okay, Romans 5:8, God showed his great love to us by sending his son to die while we were sinners. Do you see the initiating action and love of Jesus Christ upon you? Even though you went to his cross with crap, garbage. You went to his cross with sin and failure and rebellion. Garbage. Death. That's what you brought to the cross. And he said, I'll take that. And even though I brought what I call my big old mountain, my Everest of sin, right? Even though I brought my Everest of sin to the cross, which deserves, by the way, penalty and punishment, yet, Romans 3:24, with undeserved kindness, see, you didn't deserve it, right? You wronged him, but with undeserved kindness, God declares you righteous through Christ when on the cross he releases us. He sets us free from the penalty of death that we deserve. You bring nothing but failure and rebellion to God, and he brings perfection and eternal life to you in exchange. Right? That's what he does. He sets us free. And so this is how God moves on his people. He moved on you that way if you are a Christian. But he also chose you with a heart that's been transformed by this gospel to move on those that are around you, right? Undeserved kindness. Undeserved kindness. You brought nothing but failure and rebellion to the cross, and he gave you perfection and eternal life, right? So this is what happens. So Jilda, I guess she's with baby. So she is like, what the Bible says is a new creation, right? She used to be dead, right? She was the enemy of God, but she said yes to Jesus Christ. So now the Bible would tell us in 2 Corinthians 5:17 that if she is in Christ, which she now is, she's a new creation. The old Gilda is gone, dead, and arises the new Gilda, right? That's the new life. She's a new creation in Christ. The very next verse in 2 Corinthians 5:18, if you go there, please, I want you to see it. Don't just assume that what I'm telling you is the truth. Go to 2 Corinthians 5:18. It goes on to say about undeserved kindness. Look at what it says. All of this old life is gone, the new life has begun. All of this is a gift from God. So we heard that a moment ago, right? It's a gift from God. You didn't deserve it. You brought junk. Can someone do me a favor? Robert, can you turn on these lights here, those middle ones over there, so we can see. Thank you so much. All of this new life that you have is a gift from God. He's the one who brought us back to himself through Christ. So we see this reconciliation, right? We see this new, man, that's nice. We see this new thing, this new relationship that you now have with God because of what Christ did on the cross. You brought him junk. He brought you perfection. You now have a relationship with the living God, a vertical relationship with God, right? You see that in the text? Now, some people just stop there, though. But it also says, and God has given us this task of reconciling people to him. So you see, what Christ did on the cross is he restored this relationship right here with you and he, and he's starting this right here, horizontal between us and other people. He's not just saved us to him, but he's also saved us to a work, you see? He's also saved us to the reconciliation of other people to himself. It goes on. Let's read. This is kind of cool. He says, so we are Christ's ambassadors. Do you ever think of yourself as an ambassador? That's like a big thing, right? You see it on the news when they talk about an ambassador from a nation. That's a big job, right? An important person? Yeah, that's not that important. What you are, now that's important. They might be an ambassador to China, but you're an ambassador of God, right? You're an ambassador to the creator of the universe. And it says here that, just so you don't know, just in case you don't know what an ambassador is, that God is making his appeal through us. You are the chosen instrument of reconciling a lost world back to God. He has chosen his church as his only way. That's it. How will they know unless they are told? You are the one who will reconcile people back to God. So my question to you is, if you will not, how will they hear? And how will they know? So God wants you to do for others what he did for you, right? A transformed, changed heart is good for you. It's also good for everyone that is around you. Because in that transformed heart, he will initiate a relationship with a lost person through your heart, if you will do what he's asked you to do. I didn't want to talk about this next thing because it just didn't seem to fit. But it doesn't matter what I think. It's there. Last week I broke from Luke because I told you there was an elephant in the room, the election, right? Praise God, that's over. Heavens. It's not really over, but it's over. Can you guys just do me a favor? Like, this is the only church I'll speak at this week, so I'm just going to ask you guys. Get out of the fray. Would you do that? Stop the Facebook. Get over the election. And let everything you do initiate good relationships, right? Stop ripping the Hillary people. Stop ripping the Trump people. Like, if you're in this church, I'm just asking you to please do the Lord a favor, please. And just like if the other person was your enemy, what does it say? Love your enemy, right? So quit ripping them on Facebook. Just let it go, right? Just let it go. All right. So the next thing I want to talk about is a transformed heart, a changed heart is good for you, and it's good for everyone around us. We want to be effective, right? I don't always want to be right. I just want to be effective. And so we have to talk about this next section here. It's a famous section of scripture. You guys have probably seen it on tattoos. It's only God can judge me. Only God can judge me, right? Anyone ever seen that tattoo? People have it all the time, right? It's a very popular tattoo. It's a very popular expression. It's always everywhere. And just my opinion, I don't know. It's just not the gospel. It's just this one guy's opinion. I think that this only God can judge me thing is really usually just an excuse, like a hall pass, to attempt to get away with some stuff. That's just been my experience personally. Did you ever know anybody who got a tattoo and then later on in life something changes in their life and they're like, dang. Right? Don't raise your hand if that was you. But it happens a lot, right? And I think that tattoo is a dang. That's not good. Okay, and I'm gonna tell you why. Bless you. I'm gonna tell you why it's not good. We're gonna let God's word tell us why. But I cannot determine anyone's guilt. So I will say that I can't determine their innocence. It's true that only God can do that for sure. I'm not able to set the standard that you should live by. Nor am I qualified in any way to decide if you're failing that standard or if you should be experiencing some consequences for such a failure. Say, only God can do that. One person said it. Only God can do that. Okay, you got to get this, okay? There is a perfect God, and he has given us his word. And I don't know about you, but I can find... on most pages of Scripture, I can find a personal failure on most pages as I read the Bible. I don't need any of you telling me otherwise because I already know. Every day that I pick up this book, it makes me mad because I see a personal failure on mostly every page in Scripture. Are you with me? Okay, I'm glad I'm not alone. The Bible does tell us in Romans that we all fall short of the glory of God. James would tell us that we all fail in many ways. The Word of God is a universal indictment to every person, everyone on earth. Listen, God has judged. It's in the past tense. He has judged. Okay, he's like, here I am, here's my standards, and here are you all right here. God has judged. The payment for your sin is death. God has judged. He's made his decision. Here's my standard. You failed at it. You're guilty. It's done. He has judged, okay? But the gospel, the good news of Jesus, says that Jesus went to the cross to pay the penalty of your naughtiness and sin. He went to the cross for you. So all of God's judgment fell upon Jesus Christ. So is it true that only God can judge you? I'm glad no one answered, because I was setting you up. No, it's not true. God can judge you in that matter. You've broken my perfect laws. You're guilty. And the payment for your guilt is death. He has judged everyone on earth. End case. Done. However, Jesus does step in and gives you a way out of that. And that's awesome. But that's not all the judging there is. See, there's different types of judging. And I want you to put your eyes on 1 Corinthians chapter 5 for me. I like real Bibles because you can hear that noise. I think that if I was going to program a phone, like if I was going to make the next iPhone or something, I would program that in for their app, right? So when you press the button, it would go, That would be totally cool, right? There's an app for that. So 1 Corinthians chapter 5, starting in verse 12, look what it says. Are you guys there? And I don't want to pass you on this one. You gotta get this, okay? So it says right here, this is Paul writing, right? And he says it isn't my responsibility to judge outsiders. Like the people that are out there that are not part of the body of Christ, right? It's not my job. Paul's like, that's not my job. Why? Because like I just said, God's already done that, right? If you're not part of the body of Christ, if you haven't accepted this one provision for the forgiveness of your sin, you've already been judged. So it's not my responsibility to do that. But it certainly is, watch what he does here. Now he says it's not my responsibility. He's talking about himself, Paul. But it certainly is your, he's speaking to the people in the church. So now he's talking about you. It isn't my responsibility to judge outsiders, but it certainly is your responsibility to judge those inside the church who are sinning. God will judge those on the outside, but as the scriptures say, you must remove the evil person from among you. So you can see there's a difference. God has judged all mankind. Everyone's guilty. Everyone deserves death and punishment, except you get out of it with Jesus. Okay, that's his decision. It's final. It's done. But we do have a responsibility here within the church. And I want to say this too. When it says those that are in the church, now we live in a very, very small world now. Back then, it's easy for him to say that we're supposed to judge those within the church because the people in Corinth could talk to the people in Corinth, but they couldn't talk to the people in Japan. We can. You have no right to do that. You don't know them, they don't know you, and you will just tick them off and make them hate you. So we don't want to go on Facebook and say, well, they're a Christian. It doesn't matter if they're a Christian. You don't know them. You don't know the struggle they're going through. They don't know you. They don't know where you're coming from. They just hear you going, King James in the face. And that's just not going to work. He says, the people in the church need to be judged by what they're doing in the church. And so, again, I want to stress this. It's not my standards. When he says those that are sinning in the church, is it my standard that they broke? Whose standard is it? God's standard. So if it's God's standard that was broken, whose standard should be presented to the people? Yours? God's. Right, God's. So we just came out of an extremely ugly season of ripping people apart like shreds. Harsh words and rebuke from both sides of the aisle, and then also within the church, right? Very, very ugly. So how do we need to get away from that. How do we properly judge within the church? Okay, and I'm going to tell you exactly how you do that. If you go with me to Galatians chapter 5, verse We're just sharing God's word. We're learning. We're growing, right? That's all. We just want to learn God's word. Galatians chapter 5, look at verse 22. Very popular section of scripture. People don't like to hear it, but this is the truth of what it says. It says the Holy Spirit. So let me just back it up a little bit. If you say yes to Jesus, that the moment of that you bend the knee to Christ, it says that God gives you his Holy Spirit. Okay? So now this Holy Spirit of God, the third person of the Trinity, is now living inside of you. And what this Holy Spirit is doing, he's not just sitting in there, just twiddling his thumbs. He's actually at work within the believer doing something. And this is what he's doing. It says that the Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit. I would say evidence in the person's life. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness. Man, we need some of that. And self-control. We need a whole lot of that. Okay? We need all that. Those who belong to Christ, oh, I'm sorry, there's no law against these things. So those, that's God's word saying these are good things. Right? Those who belong to Christ Jesus have nailed the passions and desires of their sinful nature to his cross and crucified them there. Now let me just pause for a moment. The Bible's never wrong. There's no mistakes in his word. And it said that you put those sinful natures on the cross and crucified them there. It didn't say that they died there yet. Crucifying is a process. They put you on the cross and over time, you die. And that's what's happening here. We know this to be true because when you became a Christian, some things changed, didn't they? But some things have not. You are crucified, but you're not all dead yet. But that's the goal, to die to self so that the fruit of the Spirit can take over. We have nailed our sinful desires to the cross and crucified them there. Since we are living by the Spirit, let us follow the Spirit's leading in every part of our lives. Now listen, this is important. Let us not become conceited or provoke one another, or be jealous of one another. Dear brothers and sisters, if another believer, read on, is overcome by some sin, you who are godly should gently and humbly help that person back onto the right path. Okay, so how do we judge properly in the church? How do we do this? Because people in the church, we sin, right? So what's the way to do it? Do we get on Facebook and rip them a new one? Well, that's what we do. But that's not what we're supposed to do. It says here, we're not supposed to be conceited. Don't be conceited. What's that mean? That means that you may be right. That's awesome. But you're never allowed to be obnoxious about it. You may be right about what you're trying to say, but to rip somebody down, conceited means elevating yourself higher than you deserve to be by lowering somebody else. And that's exactly what we do in the church. It says in 6:1, to gently and humbly bring that person back on the right path. So how do we do that? Well, Psalm 119:105 says that your word is a light to my path. So knowing that they've broken the word of God standard and the word of God is the light back to the path, what do we do? How do we properly judge them in the church? Well, you don't be conceited and yell, I'm right, you're wrong. Don't be conceited or provoke them, because if you do that, what have you done? How many times has that worked when you tell them, I'm right, you're wrong? Never. Never. Right. How many people have gotten somebody saved doing that? The sweetness of God leads to repentance, not the obnoxiousness of God's people. That was a good place for an amen. Right? So how do we do it? Well, don't tell them how bad they are, but speak and display how good God's way is, right? We don't set the standards. God does. So we're to gently go and present to them, the ones who said they were Christian, present to them God's standard and say, brother or sister, you're just kind of not living up to that. And I love you enough to want good for you, and the way you're living is not good for you, and I think this is. This is what you said you wanted, and I want this for you. And so that's what we do. Always back, 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 every time back to the Word of God. I want to offer you this, and you can tell me if you think it's true or not, but I believe that the Christian is called to set the tone of every relationship that they're in. You should never, ever, ever be the thermometer. You should be the thermostat of every single relationship you're in. You're the initiator that will begin the process of transforming their heart towards Christ-likeness, right? And so when you look back in the text, it's talking to us about how we're supposed to do that. So this is awesome. He says, don't judge others, verse 37, or you'll be judged. Do not condemn others, or it'll come back against you. Forgive others, and you will be forgiven. Give, and you will receive. Isn't that just reciprocating? So what he's doing here is he's telling you, this is the way people live. If you do this, they do that. They do it back to you. You do it back to them. That's the way normally people will live. But then Jesus goes on. He's like, he gives them this following illustration for that type of relationship. He says, can one blind person lead another? Won't they both fall into a ditch? So if we live this reciprocating relationships, we're going nowhere fast. We're going to both be in the ditch soon. Students are not greater than their teacher, but the student who is fully trained will become like the teacher. That's a call to you right now. He's like, listen up and do it the way I want you to. And so he goes on. He says, why worry about the speck in your friend's eye when you have a log in your own? How can you think of saying, friend, let me help you to get rid of that speck in your eye when you can't see past the log in your own eye? Hypocrite, first get rid of the log in your own eye, then you will see well enough to deal with the speck in your own eye. Carl, can you come here for a second? I want you to help me. Come up here for a second. See this right here? I want you to just kind of put that by your eye. Just hold it right up there, right? Yeah. Can you guys see the speck in his eye? Can you? How many of you can see the speck in my eye? Because here's the problem with Christians right here. What's wrong with you, dude? Why are you doing that?
In my eye, I can't see very well.
Great job, Carl. Great job. So, are we not supposed to judge other people? See, the Bible really never says don't judge. It actually says judge well. He's teaching us how to be effective in helping some other person's heart be transformed. That's what he's telling us to do. See, the truth about what Jesus is doing here is he's telling us that before I pull my Bible out and start showing Carl what's wrong with his life, this little speck in his eye, before I show him the Bible, I need to show the Bible to myself. And see, that's what a lot of people don't do. They feel like they're the Holy Spirit police on Facebook, and they have to monitor everything everybody does. But they spend very little time letting God's Word speak to their own life. So the truth that's found here, what Jesus is saying in Luke chapter 6, he's teaching us here that through faithful obedience to his word, by praying for our enemies, which we don't want to do, for being compassionate, which we most often don't want to do because we're lazy and we don't want to go out of our way, to do good to those who wrong us, to get my life back in line with his word so I can help others do the same. See, all these do's and don'ts, they train us, see? They train us toward a transformed heart. I can't say transformed, I don't know why. Maybe I need some work, right? That's what he's trying to do. See, all these acts that you see in the Bible that are like, I don't want to do this, I don't want to do it, it's just like a long list of do's and don'ts. There's really a higher calling in all of this. It's not to suck the fun out of your life, or to put a bunch of rules, a chore list like you had as a child in front of you to make your life miserable. It's to train you for a transformed heart. in Hebrews, I think it's chapter 12. Can I have the worship team to come back up? We're going to sing one more time for the Lord. But in Hebrews chapter 12, it talks about the discipline of the Lord. When I think of the word discipline of the Lord, doesn't it kind of sound like a spanking or a grounding or something like that? But there's another discipline, right? There's the disciplines in life, like things you have to do all the time, like going to the gym. You have to be disciplined in that. Well, the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 12 that if we will sit under this training of the Lord, if you'll sit under that training, at some point you will reap a harvest of righteous living. And see, that's what God's trying to do here. He's trying to change your heart through all these do's and don'ts. Luke 17:21 says, "For behold, the kingdom of God is within you." See, the kingdom of God is not some place that someday you're going to live. You know, when you finally get out of this hell hole and die, I get to go be in heaven. That's really not what the kingdom of God is. The kingdom of God is within you right now. It's inside. That's what he's trying to build right now. He's trying to build you on the inside so he can get all the outside stuff. You know what I mean? Does that make sense? Okay. So let's do this before we sing one more time. Let's take a few moments and let's pray. And let's just, you know, let's ask for God's forgiveness. Let's repent of our stubborn disobedience. Let's, all of us, I mean, because I am too. If God's kingdom is to advance, it has to start right here in your own heart, right? Because he wants to use you to reach those other people, but if he's not working inside of you, it's going to be hard to reach the other folks. So let's take a moment and just exercise that gift of repentance and ask him to in a fresh new way, to come back in and kind of just give us another shot, right? Isn't that good? Just ask him for another shot at this thing, because we've sort of failed along the way. So Father, I just want to ask you to please forgive me. I want to start with me, Lord. There's been times that I've opened up your word and I've read, and man, I'm just stubborn. I just don't want to do it. I just don't want to do it. And it was only through careful study this week that I realized the importance of my obedience. That it's not just to help me to become more like your son Jesus, but it's because you love the people that are not in church. Because you love the people that are not part of the faith family. And you so desperately want to reach them. It's your word that tells us that it's your desire that all people are saved and come to an understanding of the truth. So Lord, I understand that for me to be used, I need to be used for them. I need to be changed by you. I need to be obedient to your word. I don't want to make excuses anymore. I just want to be obedient. Like, I mean it, Lord. I want to be obedient. I don't want to justify my failures and make excuses for why I don't follow what your word's telling me. I truly want to live the way you want me to. Lord, I know I'm speaking for a lot of people in here. We've been disobedient. Lord, we want to be a church that really, really follows you, that's sensitive to your spirit, obedient to your word. We want to respond well to the gospel. And we want to be used by you to advance your kingdom. So please forgive us, Lord, and give us another chance. I'm encouraged, Lord, that your word tells us that by no means would Jesus turn away anyone who comes to him. And so as I pray these things, I'm encouraged knowing that you just wanted to hear us say it, but your arms are wide open, ready to receive us back and to work on us afresh. Father, I want to thank you for what you've done here tonight in Gilda and with Caleb, with Jessica and Tim. I know that is such a tremendous gift to the Murata family, a greater gift to Gilda and Caleb, But Lord, also an amazing gift to us that you chose us to be witness to this. Thank you, Lord, for that. Lord, we want to sing one more time. Your word over and over again tells us to sing to the Lord. You want us to worship you in spirit and truth? Well, we heard a bunch of truth here tonight, Lord. Would you use that truth to throw us up out of our seat and release our spirit to you in worship? Would you do this, Lord? In Jesus' name, amen.